Well, this morning, I really want to jump into the message, okay? Y'all ready? You ready? It's deep. I'm telling you, it's deep. This morning, if you're here and you are hurting in any area, physically, mentally, spiritually, the message, I think, is going to speak to your heart this morning. If you're here this morning and you feel like you have been maligned, if you feel like you have been talked about, lied about, and things made up about you, the message is probably going to speak to you. God's word is going to speak to you this morning. If you're here this morning and you feel discouraged, let God's word speak to your heart and to your spirit. Hear the word of the Lord. We're going to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 12, if you want to go ahead and turn there. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. As you're turning there, I want to let you know that the message this morning is straight out of God's word. You'll be glad to know that. And it's really about grace. It's about grace. Grace is a very good word. It is a word that, it's a biblical word. It's a word that is used over 150 times in the Bible. Evidently, God thought that it was very, very important for his people and his children to know. And grace actually means it is a gift that is given to you. It is something that you did not earn, and it is something you do not deserve. But because of love, God gives it to us. Isn't that a wonderful word? You didn't earn it, you didn't deserve it, but God gives it to you anyways. I mean, that really speaks to this. Second Corinthians chapter 12, if you'd stand with me this morning, if you're able to do that, in honor of God's word. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, I want to start reading in verse, for time's sake, I'd like to start reading in verse 7, but it really goes before that. Earlier in the chapter, God took Paul up to heaven. He took him up to paradise. And he allowed, because of his grace, he allowed Paul to see things and to experience things in his life. And it was so incredible that Paul says he didn't even have the words to describe what he saw and what he heard. And that is what is awaiting you and me in heaven. And so we're going to pick up actually in verse 7 with that little bit of a background. Paul said, "Lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations I just talked about, God taking him up to heaven, and he saw all these wonderful things. And he said, lest I be exalted, or lest I be puffed up, or lest I brag about what I saw, a thorn in the flesh was given me." Now, I think that's very interesting, because if God today took you up to heaven right now, boom, there you go, and you're up in heaven, and God allows you to see some things, to experience some things, to hear some things, probably, and then he lets you come back down to earth, probably the first thing you would want to do is, what do you think? Tell somebody about it. Mm-hmm. You'd be a bragging person real fast. I mean, you would be prideful, probably, and I would too. But Paul said, lest I do that, God gave to me a thorn in the flesh. And that thorn in the flesh was given to me verse 7, a messenger of Satan to buffet me or to torment me, lest I be exalted. The reason God gave me that is so I would not exalt myself. Verse 8, concerning this thing, this thorn in the flesh, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And God said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly will I rather boast in my infirmities than that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then, Paul said, it's at that point, when I am weak, then I am strong. Amen. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes and pray to God. Lord, this morning we do thank you for your word. Thank you for putting it in Paul's heart and inspiring Paul to write these words, Lord, that we may be able to glean from that some gems, some pieces of wisdom that we can apply to our life right now, and that we can become better and not bitter. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. This morning, we're going to be thinking about grace and what all grace is. For it is very clear, if you know anything at all about your Bible, that grace is something that is very important that we all have in our lives. For to be a Christian, we ought to be known as people of grace. As a church, we ought to be known as a church, as a place where grace is. For you see, we ought to be very liberal in dispensing grace to people. We need to be, it's important to be, a grace-dispensing people, a grace-dispensing church. We ought to be a place where grace is given and grace is freely out there. And in many times it is, and I'm very thankful. We have ministries here. I'm just thinking about the Manor House. I mean, that's grace, 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 abounding grace, and other ministries as well. Grace. I was thinking about that this week, about grace. You know, we ought to be. This is what the Lord put in my spirit. I went to, a while back, it's been about a month ago, Sandy don't let me go too very often, but she did a couple months ago. And I went to the bank. And when I went there, they had this machine. It was incredible. It was absolutely incredible. I put a card in, I punched my number in, and you know what came out of that machine? Money, like $20 bills, just bam, 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 just like that. Couldn't believe it. Couldn't believe it. I said, this is a graceful machine right here, you know? And that ought to be how we are in dispensing grace. We ought to be the ATM of grace. That's who we ought to be. We ought to be the Niagara Falls of grace. For those of you who have seen Niagara Falls, it's just incredible. That's how we ought to be when we're thinking about grace. We absolutely ought to be Old Faithful. That geyser that is just gushing with grace. There's no end to our grace. It abounds. And I do believe that that's what the Bible teaches. And let me give you just a real quick setting, a little bit of history of what's going on in Paul's life. In other words, why did Paul, what was going on in his life that that precipitated him to write what we're reading this morning. Well, it's very heavy. Paul had been led by the Spirit to go to a very godless country by the name of Corinth. He was there by the leadership of the Holy Spirit. He established a church. Paul was in Corinth, in the church, for about 18 months. For 18 months, he was there every single day, pouring his life into the church. I mean, at his own expense, just all the time, just preaching the gospel of Christ, the kingdom of God, the grace of God, the love of Christ, just pouring himself into those people. For 18 months, every day he did this. The Spirit led him away from Corinth. While Paul was away, some people came into the church that Paul was at. Some false teachers came in, and they began to launch an attack on Paul. They wanted to discredit Paul and tear the church apart. And that's what Paul was writing about here. I mean, they did things in Paul's absence. Like, they talked about him. Not in so good terms. They told lies about Paul, saying he was this and he was that, when he was nothing of the sort. They defamed him. They said that he was preaching because of the money. That's why he was doing it. He was preaching because of sexual favors that he would get. That's why he was doing it. It wasn't because he loved Christ. No. He had an ulterior motive. And so they were maligning the Apostle Paul. They said he was corrupt. They said he had secret sin in his life. And it's a shame. It's a shame. Because Paul had spent 18 months of his life, probably 24/7, pouring into the people there. And so Paul writes what we're reading this morning. And I just have a sense that he's just writing it with his heart is broken because of what's going on in the church that he established. And so he says in verse 7, we read it this morning. He said that there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. And we talked a little bit about that this morning because of all the revelations and really the opportunity to brag. That wasn't a positive thing. So the Lord gave him a thorn in the flesh. And that little phrase, thorn in the flesh, that's a very interesting phrase. You and I would say, you're a pain in my fourth point of contact. That's what we would say. You're just a pain in my side. That's how we would talk. Paul said, a thorn in the flesh. Now, what you need to think about this morning, when he says thorn in the flesh, he wasn't referring to like a thorn off of a rose bush about this long. He wasn't talking about that. The word that he uses is actually a stake. A stake. So don't think of a little splinter. Think of a stake. In my mind, I see a railroad spike. That's what I see. That's what was in Paul's flesh. And it's very interesting. Because it was not something that was small and something that was just annoying, like a mosquito buzzing around your head. It was far, far from that. It wasn't some minor inconvenience. It was a major interruption in his life. And so he says, God gave him a thorn in the flesh. We don't know what the thorn was. There have been many presuppositions of what that thorn was. Can I tell you what it was? We don't know what it was. We do not know what it was. So to speculate would be, that's all it is, speculation. We have a strong idea that it may have been an individual, a person, or persons. And there's indications and reasons for that. So, Paul says, there was given to me this thorn in the flesh. It was interesting that he says, that thorn, that stake, that railroad spike, it was given to me. It wasn't forced upon me. It wasn't thrust upon me. And it wasn't inflicted upon me. But rather, it was given to me. For you see, Paul saw this. Not at first. Not at first. Because is there anybody in here that likes pain? Anybody in here likes a thorn in the flesh? If you do, let me know, because I know a couple of therapists I can, you know, send you to. Nobody really likes that sort of a thing. But Paul saw it as a gift. It was given to me. It wasn't because of some personal failure or some way that I failed the church. And then he goes on to say, this thorn in the flesh was given to me, in verse 7. And then it says, a messenger of Satan. A messenger of Satan. Had a little phrase. You know what a messenger of Satan is? The word messenger is angelos. Okay? It's where we get our word angel from. Now, what would you think would be an angel of Satan? A demon, thank you very much. There was given to me a demon from Satan. Very, very interesting, I think. It seems to indicate to me that God gave him this, or at least allowed this to happen in Paul's life. And it indicates that Satan was using a person or people as instruments to disrupt the church of God and to disrupt the work of Christ and to stop good things from happening. So this messenger of Satan is allowed to come into Paul's life. Why? Why? What was the purpose of it? Well, it tells us right here, to buffet me. Or another translation says, to torment me. God bless you. To torment me. Again, this was a lot more than gnats flying around your head on an Alabama summer evening. This brought tremendous discomfort to Paul, whatever it was. I got to thinking about when I am, and most of us are old enough to have experienced this. We've had, or at least in our minds, we have had thorns in the flesh. Anybody? Anybody have had a thorn in the flesh? Yeah, a couple of you have. The rest of you are lying big time. I know you have. I know you have. Thank you. You have thorns in your flesh, thorns in your side, something that provides or gives you a lot of discomfort. And people deal with this different ways. I tell you how I deal with it. Not real good, by the way. Not real good, so don't take a lesson after me. I'm not real good at it. But when I have a thorn in my side or a thorn in my flesh, I get to where I'm not all that hungry too much. I don't eat real well. I get to where I don't sleep so good. My sleep is interrupted. I have dreams about this. And I have nightmares even about this. I do. And it's always on my mind. It never goes away. Amen. Never goes away. I mean, I go to bed and it's on my mind. I wake up, it's on my mind. It doesn't go away. I'll get up, I'll jump in the shower, and I'll be showering. Some of you sing. There'll be some noise coming from the shower. It's not singing. Sandy said, "Who are you talking to?" I said, "Well, I'm not talking. I'm actually preaching right now. And I'm preaching to my demon is what I'm doing. That's what I'm doing." What am I telling you? I'm telling you that it never goes away for me. It's always there. And so the Apostle Paul said it's buffeting me and it's tormenting me. And in verse 8, he says, concerning this thing, this thorn in the flesh, concerning this thorn, he said it was so painful and so uncomfortable that I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. Can I preach this like I want to? Lord, please remove this from me. Lord, I'm asking you, please take this from me. Lord, I cannot go any longer, Lord. Remove this from me. And so the scripture says 3 times Paul asked for God to remove it. I don't think that's unreasonable, do you? If you have something painful in your life, don't you want God to take it away? Sure you do. Sure you do. And I do too. And Paul did, by the way, also. He pleaded with God 3 times, not once, not twice, but 3 times to take it away. And finally, God hears his prayer. And you know what he said? He said, "Paul, you are my servant, and I am going to take that away now." How about that? Well, you know the story, and he didn't say that. He didn't say that. God said, and it is in red letters in my Bible. So this is God speaking. He said, my grace is sufficient for you. Maybe not what Paul wanted to hear. I don't know. I don't think so. At that point, I think Paul wanted God to remove the thorn. But instead of removing it, God chose to deal with that a different way. Amen. And he said, "My grace is sufficient for you." You see, normally, and it is so in my case, normally, our weaknesses is an opportunity for God to intervene. Amen. And to do some good things. Amen. In our life. It welcomes God's intervention. And so God says right there, "My strength is sufficient for you." Paul, the stake is going to stay in your side. Right. The thorn is going to stay in your flesh. The buffeting and the tormenting is going to continue. But Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. Good. It's sufficient. Now, most of us, and I think I'm positive, I feel very confident that I'm speaking for the majority of you too. Pain, God allows pain to come into our life for a lot of different reasons, certainly. But I would tell you that God uses pain as an instrument to show forth His glory and to sanctify our souls. And so Paul goes on to say, he says, my strength is made perfect in weakness. Again, my strength is made perfect in weakness. You see, we want to make everything about us. But it's not about us. It isn't about us. It's not about me. It's all about God. It's not about. I know your pain hurts, and I know it's uncomfortable, and I know you want it gone, but it's not about us. It's not about my way. I want it gone. It's not about my way. It's about Yahweh. Amen. Right? It's not about the pastor. It's about the master. And we have to keep that in the forefront of our mind. Else, we will become a statistic. And we don't want that. We don't want that. So Paul, and we're going to conclude here in about 5 minutes or so. But Paul said this, and he said it in verse 10. I think he kind of came full circle on this. And he says, therefore, because of God's grace, because of this thorn in my side, because of all of this, I take pleasure. Catch this now. Read these words. I take pleasure, and see if you can say this. I take pleasure in infirmities. Infirmities is another way of saying weaknesses. Any of you like weaknesses? I don't. Do I like to show you my weaknesses? Heavens, no. No. Paul said, I take pleasure in my weaknesses. But not only that, he says, I take pleasure in reproaches. And not only that, I take pleasure in needs. And not only that, I take pleasure in persecutions, in distress. And here's the little phrase, for Christ's sake. Not my sake. It's not about me. Not about me. Never has been about me. For Christ's sake, I endure all of these things, Paul says. So in our English vernacular, I think Paul is saying this. You know what? I'm uncomfortable with this thorn in my flesh. But it's good that I don't get too comfortable. Because if I get too comfortable, I am no good to the kingdom. Because I'm going to start boasting and I'm going to start bragging and I'm going to start being so very prideful. And that is not good. Not good. So the thorn in the flesh, the maligning that was going on, you see, he goes from asking God to remove the thorn up in verse 7, I think. Three times he asked the Lord to do that. So he goes from asking God to remove the thorn to thanking Him for the thorn and actually taking pleasure in that thorn. Some of you, even as we speak, may be dealing with something, a very similar situation. Very similar. You have a thorn in your flesh. How do you deal with that? How do you deal with that? What do we do about that? The way it was dealt with Paul was that God said, my grace is sufficient for you. So, how do we come to terms with all this? How do we end this? I'd like to end it this way, by saying God gives you grace. Now you go out this week and you find somebody that you can be an ATM machine of grace, just freely, freely throwing the grace out, just like those $20 bills just coming out. You go be the Niagara Falls of grace this week, because there's people all around that maybe sitting right next to you right now that need grace, just like you do and just like I do. So go find that person.